KP's Video News.
That's right. It's KP's Video News, y'all. Yep. Got me breaking out some of my old jingles over here. Just kind of rotating through them. Yep. All right, folks. It's, what's today's date? January 29th. Got a couple of more days left in the month. This month has been zooming past real quick. Real quick. So I'm gonna dive right in. Diving right in, checking this box. And they had a small town police in Alabama are patrolling Facebook and threatening to arrest people who post negative comments about them. So the chief of police in a small town in Alabama has been forced to resign after allegations that his force was pulling over people who criticized him on Facebook and stopping people for spurious traffic violations to fill their bank accounts. Mike Jones, chief of Brookside Police, 10 miles northwest of Birmingham, Alabama, resigned on Wednesday. Lieutenant Governor of Alabama, Will Ainsworth, has requested an audit of the police force and town, home of 1,300 people, a small town. Brookside has only one retail store and a volunteer fire department, but at least one police officer for every 144 people. By 2020, the police force made half its revenue from fines and forfeitures. And the issue with police have been ongoing for several years and ensnared multiple local residents. Yep. So, you know, it says Michelle Jones, which was a parasitic problem, city leadership of Brookside and Brookside Police Department. And so she was put up an article on Facebook that stated that friends, citizens of Mount Olive and new unknown genuine social media friends near and far who have reached out to me concerning the questionable and illegal activities of Brookside Police Department located in Brookside, Alabama. Truly appreciate you keeping me informed about all the public coverage, television, radio, print, social media, in-state as well as out-of-state, concerning the corrupt leadership of the city of Brookside on down to the Brookside Police Department. Continue to keep me informed as I, along with others, diligently work to pursue the desperately needed outcome of this money-making parasitic problem that has been inflicted upon the citizens in that particular area and the surrounding areas, visitors, interstate travelers, etc. And so Michelle Jones stated that she complained to the Alabama Attorney General's office 3 years ago. She had been pulled over in May 2019 and was fined $160 for running a stop sign, which she insisted that she did not do. Jones began criticizing the police in a series of interviews and online. She said that she told them in 2020, the person threatened me with an arrest if I did not take down my Facebook pictures and posts of their police officers, stop sending emails to the local politicians as well as others, and show them, Brookside Police, that I understand law enforcement practices. Her Facebook page is full of images of the police pulling people over. In September 2019, she posted a photo captioned Brookside Police Department of Brookside, Alabama on Interstate 22, writing illegal tickets. A commentator asked if she was pulled over again, and Jones replied, no, working on something. So Reverend Vincent Witt, a Baptist preacher and chaplain of the city of Lipscomb, said that he was pulled over in June 2019 in his brand new Cadillac, which had a paper license plate as the official one, had yet to be delivered, and which said the officer called him an effing N-word. And when he complained, he and his sister, who was not even with him at the time, were charged with impersonating a police officer with their faces plastered across Crime Stoppers' website. Wow, Another woman, Lisa Ward, a candidate for Alabama Senate, shared a story about the rogue police force on Facebook and said the police chief then tried to intimidate her. A local man who did not want to give his name stated that he was pulled over by police for no reason and was reprimanded. The man stated that the officer said the chief's pretty upset about that post you put on Facebook, adding that any more backlash like that towards his police department, it'll be far worse than a ticket. I just stared at him, the man said. I was just looking at him like, so this is what this stop is all about. And he was in pure shock. So these guys were just like, anybody that posted up anything negative about that police department, at, you know, and about their practices, they retaliated against them by writing tickets and, you know, confiscating their vehicles, locking their vehicles up, and, you know, just crazy stuff, man. Illegal stuff. So the chief of police, disgraced chief of police of that little small little town, has resigned as of this past Wednesday. Okay, moving on to Florida. Got a Florida Department of State reverses itself. Camel to start representing Broward District. And a day after saying it would not send a certification letter on special election results from January 11th until March, the Florida Department of State reversed course Friday and sent the letter to the Florida House certifying Darrell Campbell as the winner in the Florida House District 94. The letter from the Division of Elections, Director Maria Matthews, which was sent to Clerk Jeff Tax as the Florida House representative, informs the Florida House that Campbell was the official winner in a universal primary election earlier this month. It ends days of uncertainty for House Democrats who question whether the Department of State, which runs the Division of Elections, would refuse to provide office notice of House Speaker Chris Sprouls certifying Campbell as the winner and allowing him to be sworn in as a member of the Florida House. Jenna Sarkeesian, a spokesperson for Sprouls, confirmed Friday that her office had received the official certification letter and that Campbell would start his legislative duties on Monday with the ceremonial swearing in on the House floor on Tuesday. The special election for HD 94, a majority Black and safely Democratic district in Broward County, was held this month along with primary elections for House District 88 in Palm Beach and Senate District 33, which overlaps with Campbell's district in Broward. All seats were emptied as a result of three state lawmakers who resigned to run in a crowded Democratic primary for Florida's Congressional District 20 to replace U.S. Rep. Al C. Hastings, who died of cancer. The general election is March 8th. Campbell will not be on the general election ballot because there were no Republicans or candidates from other parties who qualified in the race. Valerie Morgan, a spokesperson for the Secretary of State, Laurel Lee, said in an email that the Division of Electrons typically sends a courtesy letter and certificate to both chambers of the legislature after general elections so that there is one full list. In this instance, because Mr. Campbell was elected in a special primary election, we provided the courtesy letter and certificate on Friday, January 28th, 2022, Morgan said. Morgan did not give more details about why there was an unusual delay in sending the letter that would have paved the way for Campbell to be sworn in. The Division of Elections Canvassing Commission certified the results on Tuesday. House Minority Leader Evan Gene and Dania Beach Democrat said Thursday that he had heard nothing but silence from the Department of State since Monday after being in communication for weeks about the timeline of Campbell swearing in. Gene and other staffers in his office walked over to Lee's office on Thursday but were turned away. It makes no sense, Gene said Thursday, this bizarre behavior for the State Department and Florida's government. He said that the delay also made no mathematical sense because even with Campbell swearing in, Republicans still hold a supermajority in the House and committees in the legislature procedures with its session, which ends on March 11th. At the end of the day, what they're guaranteeing is that 170,000, mostly people of color, will have no representation in the House when we'll be voting on the House redistricting maps next week. The decision from Lee's office to send the letter on Friday is a reversal of the Secretary of State, which stated that it would not send a courtesy letter to the House until after the general election on March 11th. Campbell, a 35-year-old mental health specialist, has been back and forth to Tallahassee since last week. He says he's excited to finally see the Department of State send a certification letter. He says he's excited and happy, Campbell stated, and it feels like a long time coming with all the things we had to overcome just to get to this point. You felt like the day would never come. Wow. That's they was just trying to stop from certifying this guy, man. Trying to stop from certifying his election results. So we have a Republicans are mighty quiet right now. Republicans are being mocked. They're being mocked for going silent as Biden leads the strongest economic growth since 1984. That's right. Biden leads the strongest economic growth since 1984. In the wake of reports that say economic growth in 2021 reached its highest levels in nearly four decades, with an economy that created 6.4 million jobs last year, that Republicans are ignoring the strongest economic growth since 1984. After the downturn in 2020, the gross domestic product expanded by 5.7 last year, and the Commerce Department said in its latest quarterly report, Biden was furious as how the GOP would respond to the news, but all he found was silence. He was curious, not furious, curious. The RNC didn't bother to issue a statement. House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy and Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell similarly acted as if the developments weren't worthy of acknowledgement. In other words, economic growth was so good in Biden's first year in the White House that Republicans literally found themselves at a loss for words. Biden added that when discouraging economic news was making headlines last year, Republicans didn't hesitate to link the news to President Joe Biden's policies, like when Mitch McConnell released a press statement that said the disappointing jobs report was confirmation that Biden's tax and spend policies are bad for American workers, families, and small businesses. Biden, whose signature social spending bill is stalled in Congress, cheered the report, highlighting the fastest economic growth in nearly four decades, along with the greatest year of job growth in American history, even in the middle of a pandemic. And he said, for the first time in 20 years, our economy grew faster than China's. China's growth slowed to 4% in the fourth quarter, according to the official data released last week. This is no incident, Biden said. My economic strategy is creating good jobs for Americans, rebuilding our manufacturing, and strengthening our supply chains here at home to help make our companies more competitive. And Republican leaders and Trump were quick to praise the economy at GDP growth of less than 3%, even promised it would hit 4 and 5, while they never could deliver that kind of growth. Biden has, and the Democratic National Committee said in a statement. That's right. Time to deliver. It's not time to talk. It's time for talking is over. That time is over. So, that time is over. So this is what's going on, folks. And this is what happens when you have money and you have, you got access to cash. They have, it's been quite a few people that have been taking trips. They've been going out of the country, taking trips and stuff. And these people have been getting sick outside of the country. So this story here, after testing positive for COVID in Jamaica, a couple paid $35,000 for a private jet so they could fly home. And they're not the only Americans that are doing this. So, you know, on Christmas, on a Christmas vacation in Jamaica, Beth Ring and her husband tested positive for COVID-19. After spending 2 days in a state-run quarantine hotel, the couple chartered a $35,000 flight home. Ring stated that she wished she had a better quarantine plan or purchased travel insurance. On Christmas morning, Beth Ring was relaxing in a villa in Jamaica. Beth, 53, and her husband, Dan, 54, their five children, and their son's girlfriend were wrapping up an eight-day vacation, and the luxury accommodations, they said, cost about $2,000 a night. Beth Ring stated that they took a number of precautions. Most had gotten their booster shots. They ate outdoors, chartered private boats to avoid strangers, masked up in public, and prioritized activities outside. But as the trip came to a close, Ring says she noticed a dry throat and a cough. And the day before it was set to fly home to Chicago, Ring said she had her family took a rapid at-home antigen COVID-19 test, and a negative test was required to board their return flight. But Ring and her husband tested positive. The couple ended up spending 2.5 days in the government-run quarantine hotel before choosing to leave the mandated quarantine and paid $35,000 for a private air ambulance, a luxury service that has become increasingly popular among those who can afford it to get home. Time of their trip, Jamaica's health ministry required travelers who tested positive to quarantine for 10 days. The current policy has been shortened to 5 days for U.S. travelers as long as they're asymptomatic. As part of the original policy, travelers who tested positive would then have two options: find accommodations at their own expense or go to a free government-run quarantine hospital. Beth and Ring said they had limited options, that their place where they were staying had been rented out to one group at a time and new guests were set to arrive, so quarantining there wasn't possible. And Daryl Looney, an owner of the villa, stated that there were reciprocal arrangements in place to accept COVID-19 positive guests with their other villas and properties, but at the time of the Ring's travel, those locations were booked because of an influx of holiday vacationers. Jamaica in December experienced a surge in tourists with a number comparable to pre-COVID-19 times. Because of the influx of tourists, they also had trouble finding another hotel with an open room. Our hosts were making calls, trying to find us another villa where we could stay, but everything was booked. So what they end up doing, they started filling out paperwork for Air Ambulance Worldwide on December 26th, shortly after checking in on the quarantine hotel, and wired the service $35,000 for a fee. A private air ambulance service could take the Rings back to the United States, and in the event that they got sicker, they'd be back home for medical care. They're hardly alone in seeking help of this type. Since March 2020, there's been a surge in demand for private air industry, whether for medical flights or leisure. Private air travel removes the need to enter crowded airports or airplanes, making it an attractive option for those who can afford it. Like the Rings flights, these planes are not cheap. A private flight for a family of four from New York to Washington, D.C. could easily cost between $10,000 and $50,000, while individual flights could range from $1,200 to $36,000, depending on the company route and amenities. So their flight ended up becoming Ambulance Worldwide, cost them $35,000. And they say they do about 60 air evacuations between Christmas. They did about 60 between Christmas and January. Wow. Man, that little company's pretty busy. They're making a ton of money right now. They are making a ton of money. That's like I said, those are the people that can afford it. They got the money. They can do that. But if you don't have the money and you can't afford it, then that means you are pretty much stuck until at the little state-run quarantine office, quarantine hotel, until you can leave. You can leave and go back home. Yep. Way out situation. Okay. So this is a little quick story right here. witnesses in the Deshaun Watson cases are repeatedly invoking the Fifth Amendment. 22 civil cases against Deshaun Watson, which a pre-trade deadline effort to settle all of them failed to accomplish, proceed through a so-called discovery phase. Tony Busby, the lawyer representing the plaintiffs, recently discovered something interesting. In a statement released to Mark Berman, Busby claims that a witness who allegedly worked closely with the Texans and coordinated massage sessions for Watson repeatedly invoked the Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination while testifying. That witness spent the entire hour of the deposition asserting her Fifth Amendment privilege. Indeed, she wouldn't even admit that she knew Watson. The witness isn't named. An excerpt from the transcript was provided to Berman. Questions that prompted the invocation of the Fifth Amendment included, for example, whether the witness knew Watson, had a fetish to go to a massage and then try to convince the unsuspecting therapist to have sex with him. Watson can be questioned under oath after the Super Bowl, and Busby said 13 of the 22 plaintiffs already have been questioned under oath by Watson's legal team, which is led by Rusty Harden. A grand jury has been investigating whether Watson's alleged misconduct violates any relevant criminal laws. Watson remains under contract to the Texans. They surely would like to trade him, and the unresolved legal issue continues to be an impediment to any trade and, in turn, the resumption of his career. Watson didn't play not one game, not one single game in 2021. Yep. He didn't play at all. He didn't play at all. Okay. So, this story here is kind of weird. It's a weird story right there. Yep. We had this. I'm going to do this one last story. This is going to be it. A North Carolina woman was arrested after being accused of trying to scam local churches out of money. Authorities said that Crystal Gail Ingram lied that one of her family members had passed away to get money from churches. Ingram was charged with two counts of attempting to obtain property by false pretenses. A North Carolina woman was arrested earlier this week and accused of attempting to scam money from local churches by claiming that her loved one had passed away and she needed financial assistance. Authority said the woman identified as 43-year-old, Crystal Ingram was charged with two counts of attempting to obtain property by false pretenses, according to the January 27th statements from the Moore County Sheriff's Office. Officials said they received a report on Monday that a person was later identified as Ingram called several churches asking for money, claiming that one of her family members had passed away. Ingram was given financial assistance by one of the churches, but police later found out it was false, it was fake, it was a ruse. Investigators determined that the family member of the caller was in fact alive, and the suspect had lied about the person passing away to exploit local churches. Ingram was taken into custody Wednesday and booked in the Moore County Detention Center with a $2,500 bond pending a court appearance on February 17th. Ingram was also being held without bond for an outstanding parole violation warrant from the North Carolina Department of Public Safety. So, person will not be getting out anytime soon. They don't even have a bail. No bail. Yep, it's like the song said, in jail without no bail. In jail without no bail. Yep. You know who it is, folks?
KP Video News.
That's right, folks. Time for KP Video News, y'all.
KP Video News.
That's right. Doing the dues, y'all.